The views and opinions expressed in the following program are those of the hosts and guests, and not necessarily those of the staff or management of Worldwide Digital Broadcasting Corporation.
Rise!
Get yourselves together!
Rise!
Stand up and live your life!
Rise!
Get yourselves together!
Rise!
Hands up high!
To the Rise Above show. I am Joe Peroni.
I'm Heidi Mancini.
And we have announcements today.
We just want to take a moment to thank Jay Jung from City Athletic for sponsoring the Rise Above show. We're live today at WWDTV.com. So you can catch us live right now. And the show will be archived on probably by Sunday. We'll have it in the archives.
Yep.
And if you want us to help us help you advertise for a service, a product that you have, Joe and I would be happy to do that on our show. Get in touch with me about sponsorship, and we'll see if we can work together and help each other build our businesses.
Boom.
Boom. Cool. That's all I got.
Boom.
Carlota.
Hi.
All right. So we have a special guest today. The most popular DJ in Las Vegas.
Wow, that's a heavy title right there.
For sure, right?
I don't know if I can live up to that.
And, let's see if we can get the name right now. Go ahead.
Yeah. Don't say my whole name. Hold on.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
No,
you
no,
can't
no,
do
no,
that.
No.
Yeah, we don't do that.
Yeah, we don't do that. Carlota.
Sexy Carlota.
You guys giving me the heavy titles over here.
Seriously. Why not?
Well, hey,
so
right.
Tell everybody the station you're on, just in case they don't know who you are, which I
kind of
doubt.
I know. Well, it's probably more likely they don't. Comp 92.3, 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. I'm the lunch lady. I have the box lunch.
The box lunches.
And I do freaks. Maybe John likes that.
He likes the box lunches. Did you ever call in for a box lunch?
Yeah. I got a box lunch.
So there's a double entendre there, obviously.
Is it double? It's like quadruple. Think inside the box. That's actually one of the imaging.
Think inside the box?
Think inside
don't
the
think
box.
Outside the bun.
So we're
or the
going
box.
There already?
Of course, we have to.
Yeah.
So tell everybody what kind of music you play. I mean, obviously
we play hard rock. Active rock is the format. So we go from, you know, Godsmack, Metallica, Disturbed. Our oldies would be Iron Maiden, Black Sabbath, Judas Priest, the heavier end of classic rock. Not the Aerosmiths or the.
How about Led Zeppelin? Are they still in the mix
little,
or no?
No, they're a little bit, but they're still they're a little bit too much on the other side of it. We're a little bit more metal when it comes to our, especially when it comes to the gold library.
But how about Pink Floyd?
No, Pink Floyd's too mellow.
I've
I love
heard
Pink
them,
Floyd.
Though. I know you do. That's what
yeah,
I said.
I love Pink Floyd. My favorite song, one of my favorite songs, and I know it's probably what you were looking at earlier.
Oh, you don't even know. Do you want to play Name That Tune?
Sure.
John, you ready? See if you could name the song. Do you got it lined up?
I have to actually.
How am I doing with my background
so
check?
Long. Good, man. I actually, every time this song comes on the radio, I have to listen to it because I have to honor my career because I did. It's because of this song and a DJ coming on after this song saying, "There's Andy Gibb with I Just Want to Be Your Underwear." And I was in the back of the car with my dad, and I thought that was the funniest thing I'd ever heard in my life. And I knew right then I wanted to be the voice that came out of the box in the car. And so every time that song comes on, I listen to it to honor the career.
All right. So yeah. On your playlist, we've got Avenged Sevenfold, Godsmack, Metallica, and Andy Gibb.
And Andy Gibb. Yes, and Andy Gibb. Yeah, I know. And it'll pop up too, and I'll be like, oh, God. I have to listen to it because I have to honor I have to honor it as my career. Yeah,
there you go.
Yeah.
So what does it feel like to have your picture on a bus?
Oh, I know. You know what's funny? It's awesome. That's what it feels like. It's awesome.
Have you taken a picture of it?
Yeah, I have. You know, it's funny is because when I started my career, I thought that that was the peak of the career. Like, you made it. If you got on the side of a bus, you made it. And as I kind of, and I thought getting to New York was also the big, like I needed to be on the side of a bus in New York. And I realized fairly quickly that that wasn't actually the brass ring. You know, that didn't it was just, it wasn't, so I kind of like let it go, and I didn't worry about that, and it never bothered me that I didn't make the side of a bus or that I wasn't going to New York or whatever. I understood the business a little better. So it didn't bother me, but then, you know, when a couple months before the bus campaign came out, they were like, you're going to be on the bus. And I don't know, then that part of me, the young Carlota, part of me like went, wow, that's pretty cool. So it's pretty cool. It's real cool. My mom was like, wow, you know, because that's why I said it when I started my career. I'm going to be on the side of a bus.
So did you ever like...
On the side of a bus.
And I made it, yeah.
Did you ever stand outside, you know, the bus and... do one of these to see if you recognize.
No, but I did walk up to the bus stop.
The bus stop.
The bus stop. There's, you know, we have our own bus stops, and I did walk up to mine, and it was surreal because it does look like me.
It really does look like me.
Yeah, and I walked up, and I was like, wow, this is really crazy.
I think that's the one I used to put on the your announcement.
Probably. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah.
I thought it was
It's
cool.
On Rainbow and Gowan, I think. Yeah. Mm. So it was really weird walking up. And it's when I walked up, I was trying to get a picture of it, and this guy walked by. This total stranger walked by.
Like,
and he looked at me, and he goes, you look good, girl. Like, whatever. And I go, no, I'm trying to get a picture with me. And he looked at the, you know, the poster of me, and then looked at me, and he goes, that is you, isn't it? And I go, yeah, it's me. I'm trying to figure out how to get this done. So, yeah, it's pretty cool, though. I have to admit, it definitely...
Yeah, that would be awesome.
Yeah, there's no being cool about it. Like, yeah, it's all right. It's like, no, that's cool. Pretty cool. So
tell us about the event that's coming up this weekend.
Las Rages tomorrow and Saturday. Downtown Event Center, and it's huge. Many Anthrax and Killswitch Engage and... Man, just a ton of bands. Godsmack is headlining Friday, and Avenged Sevenfold is headlining Saturday night. And it's super cheap, and it's downtown Event Center. It's really nice. I just spent the day down there. I'll be there for 3 days. Today was day number one. And the one thing that we have, and this is going to be weird, but it's true. The one thing that's always difficult at festivals is the bathroom situation, especially for women, right?
Yes.
Horrible. You don't ever, you're like, oh, I gotta go to the bathroom. It's totally dreadful. Not this one. They have these huge trailers of bathrooms, and they're like clean, individual bathrooms. You know, there's like 13 stalls in each individual trailer. So, for men too, but you guys, the world is your oyster.
Yeah, I don't need any of that.
Wherever they want. But for us, you know, women are not gonna have to worry about it. So that was like a big thing to me. I was like, oh, good. I don't have to. We're not going to have to worry
stress
about it
about
out there.
That.
Yeah, because it's stressful. It sucks. Going to
See, we can't pee in a bottle.
Yeah, we just can't hide behind a tree
behind
and get it
tree.
Done, you know? Like, so it really is crazy, but it's a big deal. It's a big deal to be able to go to the bathroom comfortably at a festival. So
you going to be up on the stage to announce any of the bands?
I guess,
or no?
I don't know.
Oh, come on. It's like the bus thing, of course. Like, yeah, not a big deal, but it is a big deal.
Yeah, I don't know. I guess. I mean, I guess we're supposed to.
Yeah?
Yeah, I've been doing it so long that part's just kind of like...
You were on stage for with Metallica, though, right?
Oh, yeah.
That was
good.
Do
you ever
get
starstruck where you can't talk to them because they're your favorite kind of...
Not rock stars, no. Rock stars I don't have any issue with. It'll be athletes.
Oh.
Athletes that, yeah, if I meet like Tony Gonzalez was my favorite football player of all time because I'm a Kansas City Chiefs fan. Huge Tony Gonzalez fan. And first time I ever met him, I was like, I love you. You don't even know. I love you. He was like, cool. I was like, no, you don't know.
You have no idea.
But no, not rock stars, no. No, I know.
Yeah, you got used to it, huh?
They're part of my job. Yeah, they're just part of my job.
Who would you want to interview that you haven't, living or dead?
Bono from U2. I would like to interview. Even though he doesn't, fit the format, I would love
to
interview
Andy
him.
But
well, Andy Gibb ain't no down around. I don't need to. Andy's probably boring. But Bono, I would like to interview Bono because he's just such an interesting guy.
Yeah,
probably him. I've interviewed Robert Plant. I've interviewed Ozzy. Wow. I've interviewed so many of the big ones. James Hetfield. You know, I've interviewed all the big ones. So Jimi Hendrix would have been cool. I would have loved to have interviewed Jimi Hendrix. What would you ask him? Freddie Mercury.
Oh my God, he's my favorite.
I don't know. Yeah, I would, each individual, but yeah, I don't know. Ask him all kinds of questions, you know?
Yeah. That's awesome. So how long have you been a DJ here now?
I've been in Las Vegas since 98. So 19 years, and I've been doing radio. Actually, what's today's date? Today's the 20th? Sunday will be 25 years that I first cracked the mic professionally.
Awesome.
Sunday will be 25 years. That's my anniversary.
Wow.
April 23rd, 1992.
Very cool.
92. Yeah.
Congratulations.
Thanks. Yeah, it's been a long-ass career. I don't even know how I pulled it off. I don't know how I manage. But I'm here. I'm still here. Like herpes. I don't go away.
So I hear you're expanding now, too.
Yeah. Yeah.
So you have a new project.
I do. You know, my philosophy is if you're not growing, you're dying. And being a radio personality for so long, that you've got to grow upon that and grow with that. And I've watched so many air personalities, DJs, whatever you want to call us, kind of die. And not physically. I've seen that too. But I mean, like, you know, they leave radio and they go sell cars, or they go, you know, fade away and do nothing, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
And they don't expand upon their career and their talents and their skill sets. And my skill set is talking to people and interviewing people. And I started this deal called Kill Pop. And how it was born is we were asked to do stuff for the radio station for web. And so I went to Denver and I hung out with a friend of mine who does this type of thing in Denver, and he was doing a thing called Bands on Bikes, and that was taking bands out on Harley Davidsons. And they would film it, and then they'd kind of do an interview in the middle of it all, and then he'd put it all together, and Harley Davidson sponsored it, and it was cool. And I thought, wow, that's really cool. I don't ride motorcycles because I'm a big puss, but you know, I do other things like shoot pool. And so I thought, well, we'll do it shooting pool. So I came up with this idea of shooting pool with rock stars because it's an easy sort of conversational way of doing things. And we named it The Break, and we did a few episodes, kind of demos, and it worked. Well, then I did one with Godsmack. And during the one with Godsmack, Sully, who I've interviewed a million times from the beginning of their career, was completely loose and having fun, and we got all kinds of stuff out of him that we never really get in a typical standard interview. So while we were doing it, I was like, wow, there's really something going on here. Like, there's really some sort of gold happening here. And the radio station, for whatever reason, because we're a radio station and we have other things that we need to think about, far more priorities, it just kind of fell by the wayside. And to no fault of anybody's, it's just, you know, it's just there's other priorities at a radio station. So it fell by the wayside, and I said, no, this is something. I'm not going to let this die. And so a friend of mine and I picked it up, and we started formulating the idea. And I asked Gooch, who is our afternoon jock at Comp, to join me because I know that he's demented and he's really funny. And he's very, very creative, and I really enjoy his brain and the way he does things. So, and I trust him and his passion. So I asked him to join. But here's the story. Here's the cool part of the story is when we were trying to come up with the name and the concepts of what we were going to do, which was far more than shooting pool. It was like, how do we say rock? And how do we, because one of the things, and I think you can appreciate this, is that one of the things that we experience in the rock format and in the rock lifestyle is that we aren't viable. Our music is inviable. You know, Adele's far better. You know, Taylor Swift is far more valuable, whatever. And we're just the redheaded stepchildren of musical genres. And rock is dead, rock is dead, rock is dead. Well, we're tired of that. And so we were like, how do we say, no, rock is not dead. No, we're here. We're here to stay. You know, big middle finger in the air. And
two middle fingers.
Yeah, two middle fingers and a couple toes and whatever. And how do we say, like, rock magazine without saying rock magazine? How do we say without saying it?
Yeah.
And so we were trying to formulate a name for the thing and for the project. And Slipknot sings a song called Kill Pop. And so I was dealing with, I do the music at Comp, and so that kind of came by me, and I was like, that's it. That's it. You know, Kill Pop magazine, Kill Pop whatever, and I was like, that's it, that's it. So we started formulating that, because we thought that's the one word that says everything. And Corey Taylor, who wrote the song, called me one day to do an interview, and I wanted to make sure that we were okay using his song title. I knew legally we were. Right. But I want to, you know, he's a friend. I don't want to step on him, you know. I want his blessing. So after the interview, I said, Corey, I really want to talk to you. And he was like, cool, you know, call the wife, because, you know, I'm friends with his wife. Call the wife, come on over, blah, blah. So we go to his house on a Monday night, myself and Gooch. And I have the computer in front of me with the makeshift website of Kill Pop, the logo, the whole bit's up. And his wife is sitting to my left. Corey Taylor's right in front of me, and Gooch is next to me. And I'm telling them this whole story about if you're not growing, you're dying, da da da, blah, 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 da 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 da, and the whole project. And they're in. They're like, yeah, and they're listening to me, you know. And I go, so, you know, when it came to the name, you know, we were trying to figure out, how do you say rock without saying rock? How do you say middle finger in the air without saying it? You know, how do you do F you, you know, and all these things without saying it? And they're like, yeah, you know, like, how do you do that? You know, they're totally into this story, right? And so I took the computer, the laptop, and I go, so, basically, we're here to ask for your blessing to marry your daughter. And I went, and his wife was like, oh, my God, that's badass. She was like, you know. And Corey was looking at it, and he was like, I got no problem with that. And that was it. Boom.
That was it.
Was like, as soon as he said yes, it was on. He even agreed to do videos with us, which we've done. We took him comic book shopping, which is already out in an awesome video that you can check out. But we just did the coolest thing with him, which is not out. We took him ghost hunting with paranormal investigators and a psychologist and everything through a haunted house here in Las Vegas. And it's Red Fox's house, Sanford and Son.
Oh, cool.
Really cool. We got a lot on camera. Can't wait for that to come out. But yeah, so once he said yes.
I'm glad you explained that whole Kill Pop thing, because I was trying to figure out how you came up with that name and what it even meant. I'm like, Kill Pop.
Well, it's a love song. It's a love-hate song to the music industry because of exactly what I was telling you. Mm-hmm. You know, Corey is particularly frustrated, and he's kind of the lead on this in the music world. Like, don't tell me I'm not viable. Mm-hmm. Don't tell me my blood, sweat, and tears, my songs, and my words, and my music isn't viable because it's rock. You know, like, he's really hardcore about it, and we appreciate that. He's like our general. You know what I mean? So he wrote that song, and so, yeah, it fits.
Well, that's something Joe and I talk about, too, is the music, the rock music, and we always think, well, are we just getting old that, you know, we just can't get into some of the music of today? And
Well, you know.
But
no, it's true.
But there's no music today like there was.
That's not true. That's not true.
There's some.
That's not true. There's a lot of great music. It is a generational thing. Cause that's why every generation says it. Every generation says there's no music like there's when no I music. Was a kid. You know, when Zeppelin came out, your parents were saying it's not Elvis. You know, and now they're saying it's not Zeppelin. You know, and now they're even saying it's not Nirvana. You know, it's generational. So, yes, you are getting old.
Carlo, you're so
true.
But that was going to be one of my questions, too, I was thinking before, you know, setting up for today's show. Like, okay, am I allowed to ask you your age? Like, within general range?
Sure.
Like, I'm 51.
So. Yeah, I'm a little younger than you.
Okay, close enough.
But not a whole lot.
All right, so let's
so
say...
So we're the same generation.
Yeah, we're the same generation. Uh-huh. So let's say the greatest song that was ever written came out today. Mm-hmm. Would you and I or Heidi even recognize it as being the greatest song ever?
Maybe not.
Right, because it's kind of like... I was thinking like, mm-hmm. Okay, let's take... When I was a kid, right? I'm like 10 years old, and I'm listening to like WPLJ in New York, mm-hmm. and they would do these things where they would play like an hour of The Doors, an mm-hmm. hour of this, and all of a sudden mm-hmm. you're discovering stuff.
Sure.
You're discovering yourself, mm-hmm. and then you're putting the music to it, and then you have talent shows, and they're playing Free mm-hmm. Bird, and you're watching your best mm-hmm. friend try to play. There's so much attachment to certain songs that. Would you and I be able to have the same feeling of a new song today as we would from when we heard Stairway to Heaven?
No, and the key thing that you're mentioning is things that are so—you're talking Stairway to Heaven, you're talking about an Hour of the Doors. Mm. You've mentioned songs that would never make it today,
right.
And it's because of the attention span of everybody. We talk in text.
Very good point. Yep.
That when our conversations are text, and they're all 214 characters. We talk. I mean, that's our attention span now. You know, tweets, things like that. So songs are in the same vein. Even a video on Facebook, it better not be more than a minute.
Yes, people will watch it.
True.
People. I mean, it's really difficult to get somebody to watch something more than a minute. It's really got to be compelling. So. There's a whole reason for that. That has nothing to do with quality of anything. You know what I mean? Stairway to Heaven would never make it today. Never.
It's
one of the greatest songs ever written.
Yeah, the first chord part, right? I mean, it's like 3 minutes. It's mellow. What would happen today? Everybody go... You know.
It would go ding, 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 and it would go right into vocals.
Yeah.
It would be 3.5 minutes long and done.
Yeah, that whole long solo
all
building up to it, all that.
There's no guitar solos anymore.
Yeah, that's kind of true, too.
That's a lot true.
Yeah, because Heidi and I listened to something the other day, and it's like, I forgot who it was, and I don't want to say it was bad anyway, because I don't want to name any names, because you know who they are.
Well, it's okay.
But it was interesting, because I was like, hey, listen to this part. I'm sure this guy knows how to play. I'm sure he does. But it's interesting. You hear a couple of hard chords, and then you hear like one or two notes that come across as screeches.
Mm-hmm.
And you're like, I know this person knows how to play scales and all that, but it's just like...
They can't.
It's like one note, two note, boom, back into it. And I'm like, that's got to be there for a reason. Because I know when this person plays at home, they're not doing that, right?
Oh, yeah. No, they're jamming.
Yeah. I mean,
they're doing their Jimmy Page, you know, at home. Yeah, no. It's, you know, when I say you're getting old, I don't mean it in that way. I just mean it in the sense that we have a different mindset. I'm getting old, you know. But for me, I have to... I ain't that much younger than
you're a dinosaur.
But what I have to do is because of my job and because of what I stay young musically.
Right.
Is my point. Because I work with it and I have to listen for what is good and what's gonna make it and what are the kids listening to and why. And I find the beauty in it because I have to in my job. Not that I'm forcing myself, but it is my job. And because of that, I have an ear for what's happening.
Right.
So if I didn't do what I do for a living, I would be in the same boat as you guys. Like, you know, it's not Pink Floyd, you know, whatever. You know, it's not Jimmy. It's not Zeppelin. It all sucks.
My young clients, they keep me in the loop. Like when we're at the gym,
and I
have a client, Amber, and the music will be in the background, and she'll go, you know, what do you think they're saying here? And it's some new hip-hop something, whatever. I have no idea what they're saying. She'll start singing it to me, but it's the same words 100 times, like you just said. There's no whatever. And she gets the biggest kick out of me because I have no clue what's going on. So she kind of keeps me in the loop. And then my daughter will send me music, and she'll say, Mom, you know, listen to this song. And I listen to it, and some of it I like, and some of it I go, okay, I understand why they like it.
Do you know that people in hip-hop say the same thing as people in rock? The older people, you know, who went through hip-hop through the 80s and the 90s, when, you know, and when hip-hop really did have something truly to say,
NWA
and all that, you know, and they're not.
Who's my Shanaynay, right?
Right.
I'm in the gym working out. I go, who the hell is Shanaynay? And so one day I asked her, I go, Amber, who the fuck is Shanaynay? Yeah. Like, this song is so stupid to
right,
me.
Exactly.
She goes, it's not a person. Isn't it a dance, or is that something else? I don't know. But anyway,
she
clarifies everything for me so that I'm very cool on what's going on with the music.
But people, older people who are hip hop aficionados who grew up with it feel the same way. Like hip hop doesn't say anything anymore. You know, it's got no blah blah blah. You know, and I think that's what we're always gonna do.
Mm-hmm.
Is
yeah.
You know, there's no music like when we were young. Because we're attached to things. You
yeah,
know,
no, it's
older.
True.
Well, here's
it's
the other part of it. Back when the music was being written years ago, they used to have innuendos to what sex, like they would say sexual things in the song, and you kind of, you'd listen to it later and you go, oh, they're saying something nasty in there, but they're not coming out and saying it.
Right.
The difference today is they come right out
they've
and just say.
They've upped the ante, they have
you know,
to.
They've upped the ante to say, you know, basically what they want to do. So it's basically kind of the same, but they're just being a little more on the forefront with it now. Where years ago, what was, you know, name some songs from the 70s, Skyrockets in Flight.
Oh, yeah, yeah, Imaginary
Have an
Lover.
Orgasm, you know.
Imaginary Lover.
Yeah, it's like.
Today it's I go home and masturbate.
Yeah, well, go home and masturbate.
La, 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 la.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly.
Right?
Yeah. It's true.
I like that song too.
Imaginary Lover? Oh, yeah.
You know who it is? It's Atlanta Rhythm Section.
Yeah, it starts with an A, is what I was about to say. Are we going
to
start busting out
Pogo
and stuff? Come on. Man.
Did you listen to that song a lot?
Ambrosia?
Did you listen to that song a lot, Imaginary Lover?
I heard it last
yeah,
night.
Yeah, she did. I could tell. I could tell by your eyes he's trying to lie. He listened to it a lot.
You're listening to Yacht Rock over here.
But so society changes, right? But okay, so is it that art imitates life or life imitates art? Like,
it's a mix of both.
Yeah,
it?
I would think. But like today, because you're more up on it than I am, does it seem like the music that's coming out is trying to satisfy, let's say, the public? In other words, to make money, do you think?
It's to make money. So
or
not-
the other way. Like, think of it like this. Like, okay, let's go back to really far back. Let's say Iron Butterfly, right? They come out with a 17-minute song. Like, who was looking for a 17-minute song?
No one.
So
even then.
Right.
But, like, you know, especially like, Iron Butterfly.
or Pink
Floyd. I
never
even heard of that.
Pink
like,
Floyd, now we can talk Pink Floyd.
Yeah, okay, let's talk Pink Floyd.
Let's talk Pink Floyd.
Were artists then truly artists? Because what they were doing was that they were saying, this is what I do. If I have an audience, great. Let me pull the audience in. As opposed to now, it looks like people are kind of, they're trying to figure out, okay, what's the demographic? 25 to 35,
well, yeah, they're,
1 minute, yeah. You know, type of thing here. Yeah. Okay, let's just give them what they want, as opposed to being an artist and having the people flock to them.
Yeah, I mean, there's a definite issue with the business of music now. And the art of music.
Right.
You know. But the good ones still get through.
Yeah.
The good ones still get through because we are still people looking for good music. So, and, you know, even in the pop culture that we hate, that we're not fans of, there's still good music there and there's still good artists there. You know, yeah, the cookie cutter McDonald type, you know, flinging burger music is still there. But it's always been there. Bay
right.
City Rollers. You know, we can go through history and talk about crappy pop.
Oh, yeah.
And we can talk about amazing pop. Huh. You know, and music in general, all music is pop. It's just a matter of what flavor you put on it. You know what I mean? It's all written, the Beatles, you know, it's all written in a way, you know, to create hooky stuff. So you got Bay City Rollers and really, really crappy music like that from the 70s and really crappy pop from the 80s. And you got crappy pop now, but you have really good pop. Michael Jackson.
Justin over there going, I like the
Jackson,
Bay City.
Madonna.
No.
And you have really good pop now, like Lady Gaga.
Right.
Who's amazing.
Yeah, yeah, she's actually talented.
She's amazing. Yeah. She's beyond talented. The woman is crazy good. But, so there's always bad pop and good pop, always. Mm. Justin Timberlake is amazing as well.
Hmm.
You know, I don't need to pop his album on, but there's good music no matter what.
Right.
Always in every decade. And there's horrible music no matter what in every decade. Iron Butterfly in particular.
Well, I was trying to name somebody who had like...
I never even heard of it. I don't even know what you're talking about.
In a Garden of Eden. They took a bunch of acid and it was supposed to be called In the Garden of Eden. Was the name
of
the
movie. Oh, you played that for me a while ago.
It was horrible.
Yeah.
It's horrible.
Well...
Of course, he brings it up.
Yeah, of course.
Did you listen to it a lot?
Many times. And I was straight. So...
It was horrible.
So how's the new Metallica doing?
Excellent.
Okay, so... They're not trying to fit into...
They're trying to fit into themselves.
Right.
I mean, if they're going to try to fit into anything, they're trying to, you know, recreate the magic that was them.
Yeah, because it sounds like their 80s sound.
It does. But it's a great album.
Yeah. No, it is. It's really,
really,
really good.
And we needed it. You know, we needed a good Metallica album. Although I think their last album was really good, too.
Yeah.
Death Magnetic.
It was great.
Yeah. Was the one before that was particularly bad.
There was one that was just horrible,
yeah,
with no guitar leads. I don't know what they were thinking.
Saint Anger.
That was terrible.
Terrible. But even they hate it. They're not even, you know, they don't even deal with it. So, but Metallica's doing great, and they're really good for the genre and the format, because they're the leaders of it. They are their own genre, really.
Right.
And they're out there, and they're leading this. Rock is not dead. It never is. Hmm. It had a lull point, though. It did. You know, there was not some good stuff, but it always does. Music is cyclical. Always is.
Right.
So rock had its cycle of, and it's cycling back the other way when you have, you know, Tool talking about coming back, and you got the Metallica going right now, and, you know, Disturbed was out. Godsmack is coming around. You know, a lot of good music is coming in, and, you know, it's cycling back to... being a force, and Metallica leading it right now is very, very good.
But times have changed, though, right? Like with these bands, and you would know more than me, but it seems like because people buy songs now,
mm-hmm,
and not full albums.
Right.
Like, let's say you and I are in a band. How are we that much encouraged to come up with 10 great songs opposed to just say, screw it and put in one or two?
The art.
You know, just... pride.
That's the art of it. Yeah, I mean, they're still making great music. They're just, what they do is they make great music, and then they go, okay, now we have to have at least two or three, maybe four songs that we can, that we really try to make radio friendly.
Right.
So they make whatever music they want, and then they put a few in that they're hoping will, you know, become radio friendly.
So it seems like that it's more important now for them to tour.
Absolutely. That's the way they make the music.
Right, because the whole million sales on albums is gone, right? Or am I wrong?
No, you're not wrong. It's a completely different game now. It's a completely different game on how they make money. Touring, merchandising, that's where they make all their money, because of all the downloading, Spotify, Pandora, all that stuff. They don't make any money off sales anymore necessarily. It's all about touring, and it's all about merchandising.
So that can actually help you, right? With let's go back to Kill Pop again. Like,
yeah.
So I would think that more and more people would be coming to town because they have to play live. They have to tour.
And what's beautiful about Kill Pop is that we're in Las Vegas, and so what we do with the artists is we take them out on their lunch break, right? And we get them, they're working, and it's a grind. You know, they're always in a bus, they're always traveling, it's a new city, you know, it's not as glamorous, obviously, as we think it is. It's not. So what we do is we take them out for lunch. Well, with Vegas, because there's so much to do in the city, and it's so easy to get to it, so quickly, I can get a full-blown thing done within an hour, hour and a half, which I wouldn't be able to do Kill Pop in any other city. Because, like, say, New York or wherever. To even get to the event would probably take an hour and a half because of traffic.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So Vegas is, we're so concentrated with so many things that we've done and that we can do. Indoor skydiving. We've taken, like, Megadeth racing. We've played air hockey with Vinnie Paul. You know, we could shoot pool, whatever, you know. So Vegas is such a beautiful sweet spot for Kill Pop. And everybody comes here.
Right. So they have to come here.
Yeah. I mean, and with Comp, and Comp and Kill Pop complement each other greatly. with Comp being such a force in the music industry as a rock radio station, we're real good here in Las Vegas, and you know, we're real well known, but we're really well known around the country. You know, we're a force to be reckoned with when it comes to the business of radio and it comes to the business of rock radio. So they want to come to Vegas because of Comp. It's such a force that rock it's a great rock city. So
now you compliment each other, but did Comp know that when you got started? Because I would picture that they might find that you're in competition in some way.
No, not at all. We're not in competition at all, actually. They're a radio station there. We're a radio station. You know, I work there. But when, you know, we complement each other because Comp does one big important thing, and Kill Pop does one important thing, and we can marry together and come together, and we have. And it works really well for Comp because Comp will get a lot of recognition and not have to work for it.
Oh, there you go.
Right, and that's cool because Comp gives a lot of support to Kill Pop at the same time. So it really comes together nicely, actually. And anybody that deals with it sees that, like, oh yeah, you know, that's really great for Comp because Comp can just go, cool, give us the content, great, you know, it's great. And we're like, yeah, cool, here's the content, it's good for us too. So no, it's not competition. Now if I was a radio station, yeah, if I was doing my own radio podcast and, you know, and it was being global and really loud and, you know, and I was taken away from Comp, but I'm giving to Comp as Comp gives to Kill Pop.
Right. No, that makes sense. So tell everybody, like, how can they see you? Kill Pop is what? It's on Facebook, I noticed?
It's on Facebook. It's also killpop.com. It's 1L, and there's a reason for that. There's a, first of all, legally, I wanted to make sure I could use the word. So we did 1L instead of 2. And also, some preacher dude in Canada owns killpop with 2Ls.com.
Oh.
And he wouldn't give it up. He wanted like $3,000 a year for it. Like, no. Nah.
Yeah, we don't need to do that.
No, middle fingers in the air, baby. So, so killpop.com with 1L. And you can find us on Facebook. And we have a Kill Pop Minute. We do daily news. We have a thing called the Kill Pop Quiz, where we do fun things with... We're just releasing that, where we ask the artist 3 funny questions, and we get, you know...
I've seen that, yeah.
And 5 fingers on right now, yeah. So, yeah, we've got a lot. We did the Kill Pop Awards, which was our big F you to the Grammys. And we did that. We put that together in 6 weeks.
Oh, my God.
That was born out of a great idea from a long time ago when I was in radio in California. And when we built Kill Pop, I was like, well, you know, we'll do something called the Kill Pop Awards, and it'll be funny, but it won't be a joke. You know what I mean? And when Beyonce got nominated for Best Rock Song.
That's ridiculous.
Really?
We fired up. We were like, well, I guess we'll be doing the Kill Pop Awards a little sooner than we thought. And we put it together in 6 weeks. And it was at the Hard Rock Cafe. Wow. We streamed it. We broadcast it. We gave away cool awards like Best Song to Get a Speeding Ticket To. That was our Best Song category of the year.
Which one was it?
It turned out to be Hell Yeah, I Don't Care Anymore. But what's funny is I did get a speeding ticket on my way to the awards. Yeah.
True story.
I got a speeding ticket. And the cop goes, can I ask you why you're speeding? And I looked at him and I go, I'm listening to Slipknot. And he goes, okay. And he wrote me a ticket. I just paid it yesterday.
It didn't work. You still get
one of the last time I got pulled over, I was talking to you on the phone. Remember that?
Yeah.
And I threw her in my bag, in my gym bag. Yeah. The motorcycle cop, he pulls up behind me and she's, where are you? What are you doing? Why aren't you on your phone? And she's going a mile a minute, and I got her inside my bag, and I'm going like this with the towels on top of it, and I'm trying to like do it all cool. I'm like, shut the hell up, Carlotta. That was the last time I got pulled over.
Yeah. I just paid the ticket yesterday.
That was an expensive ticket too.
Yeah.
It was reduced to $300 some bucks. I don't even want to know what it would have been if I wouldn't have known people.
Yeah, I know. I just
found out about that.
Yeah.
Look at his eyes. Look at him. Like, really? Oh. Look at this. That's why you guys didn't go to Hawaii.
That's why we didn't go to Hawaii.
So yeah, so Kill Pop Awards, and you know, what people tend to tell me when they really, really look at Kill Pop closer and see the potential of what we can do and what we are doing and how we're growing. Because we are growing. We just started a year ago, you know. Early MTV.
Mm-hmm. Okay, yeah, I could picture that.
Yeah, early, late 80s.
They used to have a lot of interviews, right?
In a lot of interviews, but, you know, we did a parody commercial with the guy from Five Finger Death Punch. He has Chris Kale, and he's got this incredible beard. And so we did a parody commercial of men who can't grow beards. So think Sarah McLachlan and dogs, except for men with, what is that, apicia or whatever?
Well,
you can't grow a beard.
Oh, alopecia.
Yeah. Alopecia, yeah. Men with alopecia and who can't grow beards. And it was that style, but it was about growing beards. Mm-hmm. It was super funny. Cool. So we're doing not just interviews. I mean, that's a lot of what we're doing right now. But we're growing. And we are, you know, dabbling along. And like I said, you know, with Gooch on board and his demented way of thinking, he's the one who came up with the beard commercial. Beard Strong. It's really good. Look for it. It's really good. So
this will give you a chance to be more creative, too, it seems like. That's you can think of stuff all the time.
Yeah, and it's a growing thing. And like I said, you know, we put the interviews on Comp, so it definitely benefits Comp. You know, at the same time, we are expanding our minds and our brains and expanding upon what we already do well. And we're growing it, you know, and that's a big deal. It really, if you're not growing, you're dying.
Yeah.
So
I bet you a bunch of musicians are going to want to, like, they're going to start calling you, and you're going to have to work less, let's say, to, like, keep pushing because they're going to come towards you.
You know, that's the whole goal, right? Yeah. The goal is to be where when Kill Pop is brought up, oh, yeah, we're doing that. Oh, yeah, mm-hmm. yeah, you know. How do we get a Kill Pop video? You know, how do we do a feature video? You know, instead of just the problem with it is that the bands need to get out of the rut of doing the same bull interview.
Right, right.
You know what I mean? Like, so they got to get out of that rut and understand that we are here to bring them out of that rut. Mm-hmm. We don't want to ask them how the tour is going. We're not interested. You know, what are they supposed to say? It's going terrible. What are they supposed to say? How's the new album? So we got it. It sucks. We hate it. You know. What are they? So we try to get out of that, but we do come across, you know, instances where the people around them, you know, keep them in that rut. And so the one thing they're complaining about, we're here to help them get out of that. And you know, they're not. You know what I mean?
So I do.
In time, we hope that they go.
I mean, it's not the same thing, but I noticed with our show. Like, we'll get some people, and it's like, we'll ask them some questions, and they're like, you know, they just seem really weird. Like, nobody's asked them those types of things.
Right.
But afterwards, almost everybody said, you know, thank you. Like, you're treating me like a human being instead of just like a commodity that's selling one thing.
Right.
So it's good to know the artist, right? Like, behind all that, they're human beings.
Well, and that's what we want to show with Kill Pop. We want to show way more than what other interviewers, you know, other magazines, whatever, are showing. We want to get beyond.
You want to be more than an infomercial when you're interviewing.
Yeah, we're trying to get beyond. Yeah. We want to show the people the human side of them, the things. That's
exactly.
Why we like to put them in their element. You know, like what we saw with Sully from Godsmack when we shot Pool. He was in his element. He used to hustle Pool when he was 13. He was having the best time, and so you got stuff out of him that you wouldn't normally get because he was just free, because he was so happy doing whatever he was doing. And that's, you know, Slipknot we took racing, and they were just like, oh my God, thank you so much for taking us out. And they were free and like, hey, yeah, and they'll talk about whatever, and they're having a good time, and we weren't asking, so tell us about the new album. How's the tour going?
They can only say one thing, right? They're going to say it's the best
great.
Thing we've ever
it's everything.
Done.
Yeah, it's the same thing, you know. Corey Taylor, when we did the Haunted House, I didn't even ask him a question. I looked at him, I go, we're not doing an interview, and he goes, great. And
just
we just
like
rolled.
A person.
And we just did it. So, you know, we're trying to show another side of the artist and give rock a face again, because rock doesn't have a face right now. There's very few rock stars that you would see down the street. And no, you know, Ozzy is one, but
Yeah, there's no real rock stars anymore.
I mean, there's no, because they don't get the coverage.
Right.
Everybody's all up Taylor Swift's ass. You know what I mean? Like, so we want to give good press to our guys and girls. You know, mm-hmm. I don't want to talk gossip. I don't want to make anybody look bad. Mm. We don't harp when one guy is down, maybe going into rehab or something like that. We're not going to jump on that. We're not going to be like that. We want to bring our guys up and make rock a beautiful, wonderful thing in everybody's eyes and give people content like that. Mm. Instead of, let's dig at this band because they're having internal problems or, you know, mm-hmm. this guy's having issues, you know, and the lead singer of Five Finger, you know, had issues, we never talked about it, and we never will. Mm-hmm. Because I love him, for one, and I don't want to make him look bad, and I don't want to do anything that mm-hmm. would, you know, hurt him.
Right.
In a time when he's trying to make himself better. Why? So that's not our goal.
Right,
of course. Our goal isn't to be a gossip rock magazine to hurt them. We want to be a part of them and make it a good thing. All positives. You know?
I liked a while back we were talking, you were asking James Hetfield from Metallica mm-hmm. about being a father.
Yeah. I love those questions. I love to Barbara Wawa people. Are you kidding me? I love that.
For the people who didn't hear it, what did he say?
What kind of father is he?
Yeah, like,
he's the good guy. The mom is the strict one, and he's the guy they get away with murder. You know, he's like, oh, yeah, skateboard. You know, oh, shit, you hurt yourself. Well, you know, like, I did it a million times, so. But he also said, if mom's not around, and he needs to be, you know, he will.
Yeah,
but he's definitely who you would think he is as a father.
But that would be interesting, though, to talk to them on that level because, mm-hmm. I mean, now that we're older, mm-hmm. we understand that they're just human.
Right.
And it would have to be really hard to be a parent and go, listen, I'll be back in 6 months, you know.
Well, I'm on tour. Well, they go with him.
Oh, they do? Okay.
Oh, yeah. They're not all the time, but it's a big family event. Every time I've seen Metallica, I've seen his kids.
Okay.
Somewhere in the mix.
See, that's something that people wouldn't know.
Yeah, yeah, it's a kind of a family deal, and the kids are bored to death. Kids are all. when I was on the stage with Metallica, they were right behind me. The wife, his
I didn't
wife.
Know that.
What I love about James Hetfield is his wife is completely plain looking. Like she is not that rock star like. Poor-looking woman at all.
Yeah.
She is. You would never imagine in a million years that she's the wife of the lead singer of Metallica. Never in a million years.
Hmm.
And the kids are beautiful, and they're just like,
"Are we done yet? Are we there yet?
Get us out of here!" It's Metallica.
It's just they're a like, job, right? They're like, "Come on, Dad,
over
let's
it.
Go."
They're over it. Like, Dad's on there again. Let's get out of here. You know, it's so funny. But yeah, no, I have a lot of respect for James Hetfield because of the way he is as a family man and, you know, the man that he is in that way, yeah.
I heard Jeff Tate.
Nice guy.
Queensryche. He's a good family guy, too.
Yeah, super liberal.
Yeah, that's Seattle.
Super liberal. Yeah, he's a good guy.
But I've heard that's part of the problem with the band, though, sometimes, is when someone's a good family person that they can kind of rub the other members of the band the wrong way.
You know what? Yeah. It's a relationship.
Yeah.
It's a long-term relationship. Hmm. So I find that it's probably just they're just saying that. It's a long-term relationship.
Right.
You know, marriages only last so long, typically. I mean, these days. Yeah, so think about a band. And especially with that many egos.
Right.
You know, it's not just two people. With a marriage, it's two people ego. Five people, six, Slipknot, nine. I mean, there's
a lot
of ego. Yeah, it's a lot of people to maintain and keep happy.
Mm.
You know, so it's, bands are going to always have problems. And, you know, at some point, the marriage ends. Mm. You know, and some marriages don't. The Stones, you know.
They just die.
Well, yeah, I mean, or something happens, but it's very rare, you know, that a marriage lasts 50 years. It's very rare that a band can last that long, too.
Right, that's true.
Yeah.
Oh, it looks like we only have 2 minutes to go. Oh, well.
It was good.
It went fast.
Soccer.
It's good.
So I've got a million questions, so but let me just take it to this. You have a lot of talents, obviously, not just as a DJ, but as a human being, to be able to connect with people.
Right.
What is it about your past, do you think, that kind of led you to that? Because I don't think you were born with that.
No, you know, it's funny, is one of the things, I was just talking to this, but I was always the new kid in school. I was, now this isn't great, but I was always, you know, one relative to the other, as my parents were very young having me, so they weren't ready to be parents. So I was always either with my mom, and then I would go to my aunt, and then I'd go to my godparents, and then go to my grandma, and then I'd go to my dad, and, you know. I went to 5 different schools in 1 year.
Wow.
Which is hard, but what it taught me was is how to walk into a room and be the new kid in the room and talk to anybody I need to talk to. And that is one of the biggest things that I've, one of the greatest things that happened to me. That was one of the awful, most awful things too, but it turned it into
a good thing.
And I sat in my room by myself, most of my own restriction, most of my childhood, listening to music and talking to myself, which is what I still do. Every day, I
you
sit around by myself and I listen to music and I talk to myself.
What, you were unrestricted?
I was always on restriction.
Were you kind of a brat?
No, my dad, no? My stepdad was an asshole.
Oh.
So you've taken a bunch of negatives, made them positives.
Yeah. Big time. Mm-hmm. Big time. Yeah, those two things in particular are so ingrained in me that I do what I do well on that level. Like, I don't even care if people walk in on me while I'm talking. You know, some DJs have a problem with that. Like, oh, the online air on. I'm like, scrolling. I don't care. Doesn't even. So
you graduated college and all that. I know we've got not much time.
You
have
10 seconds. Go ahead.
Yeah, but 10 seconds. So you also went through all this and you graduated college.
I graduated high school homeless.
That's what I was leading at. Yeah.
I was homeless when I was finishing high school. Yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
I mean, you know my other job, right? Like, I'm a therapist.
Yeah, I know.
It's, I got to tell you, the amount of people that complain about their past and do nothing to change it, it's so hard. And you just sit there going, listen, I can't do this for you. I just can't. Right. You have to want to do it.
Yeah.
And then I look at you and you know, I mean, we went over that the first time you were on on the show, so I don't want to bore you with all that. But, I mean, it's amazing stuff.
It's not boring. It's not boring.
There hasn't been, that I've seen, one negative thing that you haven't turned into gold.
Yeah,
that's
true. I will admit that. I mean, I have I mean, what other choice do you have, I think, is what it is.
Said, you have a choice to either come above it and do what you can do, or you can just sit in it and
I don't like to sit
be
in
the
it.
Victim. The
you
rest
be
of your
Aaron
life.
Hernandez and kill himself. Right?
He got killed. he got killed.
You think so?
Yes.
Oh come
no
on!
No way. No.
There was nobody there.
So they say they don't have to stay.
So they say.
Yeah.
Sorry, but yeah, you're right. I mean, you either. If I'm not growing, I'm dying, and that is always my motto.
So you've
if I'm sitting in my vat of shit.
You're not going out of it.
I'm not growing, unless I'm a lotus flower, which I would like, you know. I am a lotus flower because I have grown out of shit. Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah. But also, you've grown out of good stuff. Because now, being a DJ for 25 years, you've taken that and did this Kill Pop thing, too. So you know how to do both.
I really am excited for the future of Kill Pop. And,
That's so cool.
And everybody that is a part of it wants to be a part of it. And people are watching it going, whoa, what is this? You know, I'm thinking, yeah, the second half of my life, here we go, hopefully.
So I want to
please
thank
watch.
So I want to thank you for being here today.
Yeah, thanks for having me, yeah.
And tell everybody one more time where they can listen to you on the radio and this Kill Pop thing.
Comp 92.3, 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. and KILPOP.com. And you can find us on Facebook, KILPOP.
Got it. Thank you.
Thanks for watching The Rise Above Show. I am Joe Peroni.
I'm Heidi Mancini.
And
I'm Carlota.
Carlota.
Gomez.
Gomez. Sorry.